Okay. It has angels at the top and at the bottom. Here you have Ethiopia, or Africa. Now let me get a different view here. Okay, this one is with a little bit of a better overlay. So it's been redrawn so that you can get a good idea. Yes, again, from 1100 AD. Very important here. Red Sea. Here you have, here's Jerusalem. Okay. But notice how Ethiopia is oriented, and then you have Africa. You see the rivers in there. Maybe our friends from South Africa can kind of explain these rivers and what all this is. Africa. Yeah, as you know, this is no professional recording. This is just for a few of my friends. So I don't have to just jump on the phone and say, hey man, check it out. I'm just showing you guys real quick so you can see. But yeah, I believe that is still the Red Sea, and you do have Africa there. Yeah, just zoomed in a bit better here. And, you know, you can pause this and do a bit more research while I am panning through. And I'm going to go down a bit. This is all Africa. Huh. What are all these castles doing in Africa? All these kingdoms. What's that big white king doing down there at the very bottom?
Genetic makeup to make a difference. Sheesh. Get this girl some bleach and end this racial tension. Peep. How you rich but can't afford to pay attention? Most people brainwash. Why you think I hate religion? But I love God, so nah, ain't no atheism. Afro, color, black, cool, who created niggas? Watch them call me racist. What my race is? We are racist, nigga. And Obama ain't gonna say it. Pimping words like bullets. Paka, paka, I hope them statements hit you.
Got this dictionary from a patient of mine who used to be a minister. Notice the copyright date is pretty old. So what I'm finding is really interesting because of the way things are just being revealed right now. It's kind of like, why didn't we already know this? Now, I'm not claiming that everything in here is true, but there are interesting things that I've discovered. Now, let's see what it says about Ham. This is what I found so, like, amazing. Ham, the youngest son of Noah. Born probably about 96 years before the flood and one of the eight persons to live through the flood, he became the progenitor of the dark races. But check this out, not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, and Canaanites. Why not the Negroes? Those who would later be referred to as African Americans, why are they not of Ham? Okay.
age 11. Sister said that we were going to be going into slavery. Let's see what happens. It says to be sold on board the ship, Bonds Island, on Tuesday, the 6th of May, next at Ashley's Ferry, a choice cargo of fine 150 fine, healthy, fine Hebrews. Now it says Hebrew there, but we read that's really Hebrew, okay? As a matter of fact, let me diverse into that real quick. So it says fine Hebrews, right? Hebrews, right? So you would look at that and you would think that that's some damn African tribe. No, that's a corruption of the word Hebrew. That's supposed to be fine Hebrews. So let's go and prove it, okay? Let's go into this book some more. Let's go get it out the book. Okay, this is page 54. It says, the first British explorers who met the Igbos in Nigeria were quick to identify them as a branch of Hebrews. See that? So the first people that came into West Africa, the explorers, identified us as a branch of Hebrews. This was written by this guy named Baston, Dr. Baston, in 1938. And so simply referred to them as Hebrews, which became known as Hebos, Ebos, and later Ibos. Now right here, what does it say? It says Hebos. What's the guy Dr. Baston told you that's a corruption of the word Hebrew?
here it says Negro, plural Negroes, Spanish Negro, from, right, Negro, black, from Latin Niger, like this, we get Niger, Nigeria, Niger. It says a person of the typical African branch of the black race. They don't talk like this anymore. It was too telling. They never thought that our people would read and study and seek the truth about who they are. So when we started to read these things and find out and use it as proof, this is where they had to, you know, upgrade what they were saying to try to confuse folks who are not going to study and find out the roots. It says, formerly called the Ethiopian. Let's read the sentence again. It says, a person of the typical African branch of the black race, formerly called the Ethiopian. So before they were called the black race, what were they called? The Ethiopian, inhabiting the Sudan, or loosely, right, or, let's see, or loosely of any of the black races of Africa, including, besides the Negroes, proper Bantus, that Bantu word, Pygmies, Hottentot, and Bushmen. Maybe that's the reason why they have the clicks too. See language table. Secondary is a black man, a person having more or less Negro blood. More or less. Look at Negroid. Negroid, characteristic of or like the Negro or Negroes. A member of a race perceptibly sharing Negro blood. That means, you know, looking black. Or displaying Negro traits. Especially a Bantu. So now they got some silly Ethiopians, modern Ethiopian, be educated by Ferengjoch, who are dividing and conquering themselves. We're not Bantu, we're Ethiopia. Rah, rah, rah. You see, but what they don't know is what they don't know. And so here, let's go under Ethiop, right? And notice something right here. Under Ethiop, they actually go to the Latin Ethiopes, right, from the Greek Ethiopes, right, from Athian to burn, right, plus ops, which means face. So they give you the etymological brackets right here. But now when we go to Ethiopian, right, what do we have? On the Ethiopian, it says of or pertaining to Ethiopia. It says C, right? It says G-A-Z. I don't know if they're saying Gazet or Gaz, right? Gaz. But it says or Ethiopians of the Ethiopian race. A native, right? Member of one of the former five divisions of mankind. Interesting. A native, right? A member of one of the former five divisions of mankind. The Ethiopian race, which includes the Negro, did you get that? The Negrito peoples of Africa. A Negro. Can you see that? Haven't seen that in a while. A blackamoor. See, so they've changed the definition from this older dictionary to this newer dictionary, but they still keep black, right? They keep black, but they say sense 2A, right, 2A. But now during the movement of the Ethiopianists and the Afro-Americans going to 19... turn of the century, the early 1900s, this is the original and the truer definition. But it's too telling, too much information, right? A Negro, you see that right there? A Negro, a blackamoor, says Ethiopic, Ethiopian, designating or related to the language of the Semitic conquerors of Abyssinia, right? The Ethiopic language. But see this Negro, this it says including the race, including the Negro and the Negrito peoples of Africa, right? The Negritos peoples of Africa. This is the older dictionary right here. I just saw niggles. Where is it? Right here. Niggles. You see? Niggles. Right? Niggles. It says Amharic from Ethiopic, or it says Negus. Negus, the title of the sovereign of Ethiopia. The title of the sovereign of Ethiopia. Let's go.
Shalom, Rastafari. Hey, we're going to check this out. Ask this question and seek to give a basic overall answer to it. Many people believe that all of the slaves or the enslaved Africans, the Ethiopians, the Hebrews who were enslaved, they came from West Africa. As you can see over here in the West, the western portion of Africa, these are the slave, some what they call the slave ports. They estimate roughly 12 million, whether 12 million who made it over, right, or whether 12 million who left, but this is a rather low number. You understand, they call it maybe conservative number. Another interesting point is that this area of the ocean that's known as the South Atlantic, at the time it was called, in the European maps, it was called the Ethiopic Ocean, so the South Atlantic Ocean to Ethiopic Ocean, because some don't want to accept the fact that the continent was known as Ethiopia, and before they became termed Africans, they were called Ethiopians. This is very significant, biblically, scripturally, to put the picture in its proper context and to see the big picture. So in answering the question that some have asked, didn't all the slaves come from West Africa? This particular map here is pretty interesting. It was linked to global kaput. Kaput actually doesn't mean kaput so much. It means the head, like the kaput ethiopicum. This would be a continuation, I guess, of that. So you can see that this is the big zone right here. This is the zone. Now, there were so-called Jews, Moreno Jews, and other Jews. There were Arabs, Islamists. There were pseudo-European Christian. There were animists. There were other tribes that warred with Hebrew tribes that basically come into the blacks selling blacks, Africans selling Africans. But see, that's looking at Africa as being one country. It's a continent, many different tribes, many different people. They may be the same color, but they are not necessarily the same kind. So no, all the slaves did not originate in West Africa. They were brought to West Africa. They were marched, sometimes long distances. They were marched to West Africa, right? You have to remember that there's a trifecta going on right here. We have so-called the Jewish so-called involvement in the slave trade. There's the European so-called Christian involvement in the slave trade. And then there were various different type of heathen Canaanitish African tribes also who were involved in selling the Hebrews, whether they knew it or not. Most of them didn't know this, to fulfill the true biblical scriptural prophecy concerning the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So they all did not originate from West Africa, just like they all didn't end up just in one area. They were scattered. In fact, this next map right here is pretty interesting in and of itself, because this shows the various different Goyim, right, or the European Goyim, the Gentiles who were a part of it, the British in North America, the Spanish America, the British Caribbean, the Danish Caribbean, the French Caribbean, the Dutch Caribbean, and then they just have Brazil, which is kind of very interesting. They didn't name, well, who, Brazil? Well, I mean, what's that? These people just came over here. So most maps give you a faulty impression, like, this is a good map, but what they don't want to, they just point to this, but they don't want to recognize that there were different movements going on, historical movement. If you don't know a history, then you're really missing the half of the story if you don't really know history right here. This is the conventional rationale that's given. Slave Coast, which is known as the Gold Coast, actually the Gold Coast right there, that this is where the ships docked, the various different enslaving nations. Here we got the Goyim, the European, the Gentiles, right? Enslavement of the Hebrews. But if you would take a over view of it, this map here is very, very correct. You see the various different lines? There were various different lines. It was not as neat as in one of these, like, Amistad movies. It wasn't a neat thing. going on. This is a crime against humanity, in which many folks might say, well, I wasn't a part of the slave trade. Well, no, but still, many profit off of the illegal proceeds of a criminal enterprise, knowingly. I mean, many know that even Wall Street and the wealth of the West was actually built on the slave trade, right? The slave trade, right? The slave trade of Jah's people, of the Hebrew, Ethiopian, Hebrew Israelites. In my father's house, there are many mansions, and this should be clear when you study the half of the story that hasn't been told. Like I said, this map right here is very interesting, because actually we want to create a map or to recreate a map that can be more accurate with the real documented evidence of the history. Because there's many so-called modernist Ethiopians and Africans who dispute our Ethiopian Hebrew identity in ignorance, should I say, vainly in ignorance. But even if they were to study, they'll find out that they were only told half of the story, twisted and disjangled. In fact, some show it like this. Here's how some maps. This is historical fiction right here, right? This is historical fiction right here, right? See how they show it right here? And they always like to cut off, right? They always like to cut off East Africa. Many of the African tribes, like the Yoruba, and even the Ebo or the Igbo and other tribes who still have their history, and some who actually have been recorded by Europeans and others, and Luana Equiano, he even wrote down his story, and many of them basically show that the West African movement or the reaching of West Africa was fairly recent for many of the tribes. Many of the tribes who had migrated from the East, just as the scripture states, if you look at these other maps here, you know, they like to cut off over here or make it plain, like blank, like nothing was going on. But as you study the history of what else was going on in the world at that particular time, it becomes very clear. They talk about West African slave trade regions. Because when we say Africans sold Africans into slavery, that's a very general thing. It's like saying Europeans killed Europeans. It's like saying black on black violence, instead of recognizing Cain slew Abel. So we're talking about different natures, different peoples. But if you only judge them by superficial criterion, like they're black, they're dark skin, so forth and so on, then you basically fall into that trap of ignorance, because you're not really studying the truth. You're saying that Africans sold Africans. No, Africans, the heathenish, paganish Africans who sold the Hebrews, they could distinguish who was who, because many of these new people, they felt the same xenophobia that other folks feel about immigrants coming to America, right? You know, about certain immigrant groups. They felt that xenophobia. It was easy to distinguish them from the other more indigenous or settled blacks and Africans who were on the West Coast. So they were able, when the Arabs and the Europeans and the Jews and other groups came through to buy up, or some of these Goyim, when they came to buy up, you understand, human labor, you know, or buy the so-called buy human beings, they were able to distinguish between one group and the next, the Africans, because many of the people that they were able to round up were newly, by comparison, newly arrived. So the European, he was like, oh, look at these blacks. These blacks are selling each other. But then some of the Europeans understood better, because even among the Europeans, when you look at the British, you know, the British and the French fought each other, the Spanish, the British, the Dutch, you know, the Europeans fought each other, and nobody said, oh, European on European violence, because we know the difference amongst them because of their names and their culture. But when we look at Africa, you understand, notice, it's talking about who did what. We don't even know what tribes these people are. And this is also another proof positive that we're talking about the lost sheep of the house of Israel. We're talking about the biblical prophecy of the Hebrews or the Israelites, according to Deuteronomy chapter 28, the curses, verse 15 to verse 68. But some of these more modern researches are picking up on the truth, whether through our ministry or other ministries, and they're doing the research to verify for themselves that you had such migrations around here, you had such marches, the marches through the desert. This is one reason why when we look at Africa today, they can't really get their acts together. You understand? It doesn't seem like Africa can get its acts together, because it's like you sold the best people, quite, you know, overall. You know what I mean? Those who could not be sold were still living according to some semblance of the Hebrew, right, of the Hebraic, the Al-Kidan, the B'nai B'rit.
So now, when you start seeing these are phosgene patterns taken by the brain in higher thought patterns. And they have become a language. They're not only the phosgene imprints of thought patterns, next. They're also the star configurations around your head. Look, this is the astral alphabet. nations that it's akin to. Here you have the specific constellation that they are connected to. And here you have the Hebrew alphabet. Notice, brothers and sisters, that the language of light and the Hebrew alphabet, you're looking at flames. If you were to take a candle and light a match and watch a flame dance back and forth, you are watching the language of fire speak to you. Well, all light, all language is based on light. And what's the best evidence or physical evidence of light? Fire. So fire is essentially, these are the kumadu of the fire language that our ancestors created in order to encode the millions of years of information that they had. They had to make it in coordination with your own mind, your own brain work patterns. Next. So what are we looking at? We are looking at the Sephiroth as the audio spectral geometric template of universal existence. Next. And they repeat in a cycle and exist in 231 gates, and it comes to pass that all that is formed and all that is spoken emanates from a single name, the Sefer Yisrael. This is what they hid from you. This is what they hide from Christians when they say in the beginning was the Word. You think some jackass named John said that. John didn't ever exist. John is a formula. John is a formula because there was no J's back then. It's I-O-N, which is an ion, so it was the atom speaking to you, fools!
Who did this and who is doing this to you? Who has stolen all that you are and all that belongs to you? It was 1,000 years ago when this devil was unleashed from his prison and he wrote the words, "Now I cannot beget the fourth son whose children I would have ordered to serve you and your brothers. Therefore it must be Canaan, your firstborn, whom they enslave, and since you have disabled me doing ugly things in the blackness of night, Canaan's children shall be born ugly and black." Now who said that? Who was this devil? It was the esteemed among the false Jews, Rabbi Rashi, known as Solomon ben Isaac, who stated those words. This demon went on to lie and say, "Moreover, because you twisted your head around to see my nakedness, your grandchildren's hair shall be twisted into kinks, and their eyes red, again because your lips jested at my misfortune. Theirs shall swell, and because you rejected my nakedness, they shall go naked, and their male members, that is the penis size, shall be shamefully elongated." Now how many women are complaining about that? And then he went on to say, "Men of this race are called Negroes. This is where they renamed you. The false Jew renamed you, stole your birthright, stole your land and your resources, and renamed you to Negro." This devil and the Mormons love to lie. In the Book of Mormon, 2 Nephi, the 5th chapter, it says that the Lord God did cause a skin of blackness to come upon them, black like flint, so that they might not be delightsome to my people. However, but if you read in the Bible, in the Book of Numbers, the 12th chapter, Miriam, the sister of Moses, was turned white skinned, white as snow, and it was not a blessing, it was a curse. If you go to 2 Kings, the 5th chapter, Gehazi in the Bible was turned white skinned. It was not a blessing, it was a curse. And it said that his seed will be born, that is, his children will be born white skin. These lying devils have stolen your birthright, and they got you believing and drinking the lying Kool-Aid.
Before you was a dime piece, you was Israelites. Before you tricked up in the streets, you was Israelites. Before they took you out them ships, you was Israelites. Before a nigga was a nigga, we was Israelites.
I'm an Israelite.
Nah, we ain't no niggas, man. We Israelites.